Okay, I think I've got the timing thing cracked. I believe I have told my phone to set an alarm 10 minutes before I'm supposed to shut up, and then do it again 5 minutes before I'm supposed to shut up, and then do it again when I'm supposed to shut up. It may go wrong, and it might be operating on GMT anyway, but we shall see what happens. I'm fairly confident. Okay, so I think we're running just a few minutes late. On the other hand, there's a sort of 10-minute break at the end of my session before the following one, so we can probably catch up and just shorten that break off a bit. The topic I'm going to be talking about is calculating selectivity. There's a little introduction to me, but we don't really have time for that. You probably know who I am. Oh yeah, there is one important thing here. See the bit down the bottom where it says O-1 visa for working in the USA? I let that lapse about 10 days ago, so I'm no longer an alien of extraordinary ability. I am just a tourist of extraordinary ability. Okay, because I've got quite a lot of stuff in here and we'll go at quite a pace, I'm not sure that we will actually get through all of it, so I've sort of deliberately got a breaking point. I think it's about 36, 33 slides in. So what I'm going to do is give you the closing section of the presentation first, which is the warning and the conclusion. And my warning starts here. I'm just going to do a create table statement. As you can see, I've got a very large number of rows, generating a million rows, which I'm going to select. I've got two columns here, mod 200 and mod 10,000. The way they're defined, there are 200 distinct values here. There are 10,000 distinct values there. And then, having created that data, I'm going to create stats on that data, and I've got their size one, so I'm not creating histograms. I'm then going to create an index, which is on those two interesting columns, the mod 200 and the mod 10,000, and do a select statement which says, select a particular pair of numbers. Mod 200 equals 100, and mod 10,000 equals 100. Now, if you work it through a little carefully, you will realize that every time that mod 10,000 is equal to 100, mod 200 is also equal to 100. There is a 100% overlap there between the mod 10,000s and the mod 200s. So, a bit more arithmetic, this will return 100 rows. However, the optimizer assumes independence of predicates as a general principle. So the optimizer is going to say there's 200 possibilities here, there's 10,000 possibilities there, that's 2 million possible combinations, we should get no data whatsoever. At least that's what it would have said in something like Oracle 10.1. However, I happen to have created a suitable index on this particular data. So when we get to Oracle 10.205, and slightly earlier than that, but this is the latest 10.2 version, 10.205 says, yeah, actually, I've got this index, which is a perfect match. It's a non-unique index. It's a perfect match for your particular data set, for your particular predicate. And I can work out, therefore, that there are going to be 100 row IDs that I find in the index, because I can see that the number of distinct values in the index is actually 10,000. It's not the 2 million possible combinations. So on the index range scan, Oracle says, I can see what's going on. I'm just going to pause briefly to make my cursor permanently visible. Unfortunately, that means I have to put my glasses on. pointer options, arrow options, visible. Okay, that's fine. Notice the odd thing? Having decided that there are 100 row IDs where this predicate will be true, Oracle then decides, despite the fact there's 100 row IDs, there's only one row. Oracle 10.205 kind of forgets that what it knows and what it's learned from the index. Oracle 11.204 has got the right answer. Oracle 11.2, and in fact it's 11.1 where it comes into play, actually uses the selectivity, the number distinct from the index, in order to work out what's happening at the table if you've got a non-unique index that happens to give you that piece of information. Now, this is absolutely classic Oracle, right? Inconsistent. You find all sorts of places where the arithmetic just doesn't hang together completely, and year after year after year, lots and lots of little things change, and as things change, execution plans change on upgrades for no apparent reason. Unless you happen to have looked very carefully at what's going on in very simple examples like this, and noticed that this is completely ridiculous, and this is actually right, and figured out why Oracle's managed to do something half right, and then finally got it right. And notice in this particular case, very simple example, but look at the cost. Oracle has actually worked out the correct cost of visiting the 100 rows in the table and finding 100 rows in the table, despite saying it will only get one row. It's expensive to run this index range scan, but it only returns one row. So in a more complex execution plan, a more complex query, the optimize is likely to say, it's expensive, but it returns one row. Let's start there. Then we only have to do it once, and whatever we do next, we only have to do once, and we're looking at a win. Down here, it's expensive, but it returns 100 rows. So the optimizer might postpone access to this table on the basis that if it goes somewhere else first, well, it's not going to save anything. It's still going to be expensive to visit this table, but maybe with a little bit of luck, when it's visited some other tables first, it'll find a cheaper access path into this table. So this little bugette means that you do your upgrade from 10.205 to 11.106, or 11.204, and the execution plans change for no apparent reason. And it's for things like this that it's important to have at least some familiarity with the ways in which Oracle calculates selectivity. Oh, here's a little thing, by the way. This trick of using the combination of columns because they're in an index works some of the time for non-unique indexes. And sometimes it doesn't work for non-unique indexes, but it does work for unique indexes. Right? And eventually Oracle will sort of sort things out so that it works the same sort of way in all sorts of circumstances. But you just do not know what it's going to do, under what circumstances, in which version of Oracle, until you do some of these experiments. So conclusion then, right? Bad selectivity leads to bad cardinality estimates. You need to know how Oracle does selectivity, because bad cardinality estimates contribute, they are not the sole cause, but they contribute enormously to bad execution plans. And if you can actually understand why the bad plan has appeared, if you can go from the plan back to the cardinality, back to your estimates of selectivity, you may recognize what peculiar quirk of the optimizer has produced that selectivity, that cardinality. This gives you a better choice of what approach should I take to resolve that problem. And the sorts of solutions you might pick up on then are things like this. And again, this is the closing slides of the presentation, because otherwise I might not get there. Oracle often guesses, and when it's guessing, 1%, 5%, and 0.25% are very, very commonly occurring guesses. So watch out for the cardinality that suddenly drops by a factor of 100, or 20, or 400. Because maybe Oracle's guessing. If that is the case, well, perhaps switching into optimizer dynamic sampling might help you. Right? So that's a possibility. Dynamic sampling at level 3 when Oracle is guessing. Other reasons why things go wrong. We saw the independent column type statistics problem, right? There are things where Oracle has to guess or has to make silly assumptions, and some of those assumptions are very bad. If you can recognize that the problem is to do with function of column equals constant or combination of columns is some value, then you can look at that and say, well, Oracle 11 allows us to create virtual columns. It allows us to create extended stats on column groups. Perhaps giving Oracle better statistics by the virtual column extended stats approach will be enough to give us the execution plan that we want. Of course, in 10G, you can sort of fake your way around this by creating function-based indexes. If none of these types of solutions actually work for you, if you find some other reason why the Oracle optimizer is doing something silly, like you found a bug or it's just completely hopeless, then you fall back to, well, maybe we just have to hint it. And maybe our hints will be baselines, maybe they'll be profiles, maybe they'll be outlines, maybe they will actually be in the code. But certainly starting back there and saying, oh yeah, Oracle's doing this because it's making this assumption, it's a very good starting point to getting better code, better understanding, and being prepared for what might change on the next upgrade. Okay, so let's start the presentation. Selectivity. Selectivity is the fraction of a data set that's going to be identified by some predicate. As a fraction, the value is going to be between 0 and 1. And of course, from our perspective, the human viewpoint, what we see is not the selectivity directly, but the cardinality. How many rows out of the data set will be returned? Oracle is doing its arithmetic basically on selectivity, what fraction, but for our consumption, it turns that into volume, right? Cardinality then, it's the number of rows that will be identified in a data set by your predicate or by your set of predicates. Okay, and very simple-minded then, cardinality is simply the selectivity multiplied by the number of rows of the incoming data set. So most of the time I'll probably remember to say selectivity when I'm talking about examples, but I will switch fairly casually into cardinality. The association between them is extremely close. Now, in calculating selectivity, there's only a few numbers that Oracle starts off with, okay? Basically, we have predicates which are about columns, so we look at user tab columns, or user tab cols is perhaps the better bet, and the equivalent DBA all tab and all the partition ones and the subpartition ones and so forth. Numbers that are relevant to Oracle when it's accessing data from the table initially. NumNulls, the number of times that this column is null in the table. NumDistinct, the number of distinct values that appear for this column, and the density. The density I'll talk about in a little more detail in a moment, but very often these two, the NumDistinct and the density, are related. Then we have the low value and high value. What's the total range, the complete range of values that this column may vary over? Those two values come into play when we start looking at range-based predicates, of course. We also pick up selectivity information from indexes. As you saw earlier on, Oracle can pick up numbers from the index to understand the data better, and that's the distinct keys, the number of distinct keys in the index. I put in num rows there as well. The rows is slightly misleading there. Num rows in an index means the number of index entries. Okay, but of course, when we're looking at num rows, that's what helps us swing from selectivity to cardinality. Hence the sort of italicization there. User tables, again, we've got num rows. Again, that's the thing that takes us from selectivity to cardinality. Now, what I don't have anything like enough time to talk about in this presentation is histogram effects. Because if your data is extremely skewed, the type of arithmetic that Oracle may need to do changes dramatically. And it gets really quite messy and difficult for all sorts of reasons to get good, efficient execution plans when you have extremely skewed data. I'm going to leave that to maybe next year, shall we say. User tab histograms, however, is the place you would look to see if you've got histogram data and what that histogram data looks like. And I've just listed the relevant columns from there, just picking in particularly one note about a new column that comes in 12C, where Oracle introduces two new types of histogram. One type being a much, much more informative type, and the other type being a much, much more efficient way of gathering the good old frequency histograms. Okay, so that's the numbers we're going to be looking at, or Oracle will be looking at. Let's just take a sample data set to demonstrate some of the arithmetic. So I've got here, again, my very large data set, right? Generated a table with a million rows, and walking down this, we've got a row with a column of 200 distinct values, the mod function coming into play there. Whoops, lost it. We've got a column here with 300 distinct values. We're taking DBMS random numbers there, truncating to get integers. We've got that mod 10,000 again. And I've got a trunk of sysdate here simply to generate a date-based column to show you the arithmetic doesn't really change significantly as far as dates are concerned. Again, 1,000 distinct values here, random variations with a trunk. I've also generated some random strings. There's a 6-character lowercase string column here. There's a 20-character lowercase string column there. Character strings are very odd when you start doing arithmetic with them. Okay, so let's start working through a few examples. We'll start with the single column selectivity, okay, SCS for short, as from here in. Select where ran 300, we've got 300 distinct values, equals 150. Select where ran 300, not equal to 150. Basically, what Oracle's going to do there is say, well, we've got 300 distinct values, we've got 10 million, a million rows in the table, divide a million by 300, bang, there's your answer, 3,333. Technically, the arithmetic is looking at the column density, right? Now, I said there's a relationship between num-distinct and density. If you don't have histograms in play, the density is 1 over the number of distinct values. Right? If you have 300 distinct values, divide the total number of rows by 300. Alternatively, the density is 1 over num-distinct, 1 over 300. Multiply the density by a million rows, you get 3,333. It may seem a little odd, of course, to have the same piece of information stored twice in the database, but when we start generating histograms, density ceases to be 1 over number of distinct. And Oracle produces a number which says, roughly speaking, if we ignore the popular values, the stuff which is the really skewed values in the system, I've got a number here in the density which represents the rest of the data. Okay, but that's our column equals constant. What about column not equal to constant? Well, fortunately, Oracle says, well, ignoring the nulls for the moment, either it is 150 or it isn't 150. So I've either got density times number of rows, or I've got 1 minus the density times number of rows. So we've got here, well, it only shows up as 996k there. It's 1 minus 1 over 300 multiplied by a million, right? So not equal to, Oracle makes the obvious, humanly intuitive interpretation of how to deal with that particular piece of arithmetic. If we had some nulls in there, if we had num nulls not set to a zero value, basically Oracle would factor that in. You know, 50% of the data said it's null, Oracle would have then have scaled the results down by 50%. Select from, and let's start playing with functions. What happens when you start using functions? Select from T1 where the sine of mod 10,000 equals 1. Well, the sine is 1 if the value is positive, it's minus 1 if the value is negative, and it's 0 if the value is 0, right? So what do we expect to see for the number of rows where the sine of mod 10,000 is 1? Select here where trunc of that date column, well actually that date column was date only, so trunc of date 1,000 is always equal to date of 1,000. Oracle doesn't know that. Let's find trunc of a function of column not equal to a very specific date. Okay, so what have we got for the mod function, sine function? The sine of mod 10,000 equals 1, Oracle says it's 10,000 rows. A few extra experiments with variations in data, it turns out that function of column equals constant, Oracle hasn't got a clue. It says 1%, which means, by the way, if you run 3 queries against this data, Oracle says 1% of your data is positive, 1% of your data is negative, and 1% of your data is 0, and God knows what happens to the other 97%. This is clearly not good. At some stage, you will write a query where you get a bad plan. You were supposed to laugh just a tiny bit when I said that. Work with me a little bit. Thank you, that'll do. Okay, what about the trunc of date not equal to, function of column not equal to constant. Again, we can see easy numbers here, 50,000 out of a million, play around with different sizes data just to confirm it. Oracle says selectivity is 5%. So again, we get into this funny sort of thing which says, well, function of column equals constant, that's 1%. Function of column not equal to constant, that's 5%. Yeah, this time we've lost 94%, right? So Oracle's just guessing. Now, what do we do? What do we do when Oracle is guessing? Well, in some cases like this one, we could say in the 11G, hey, let's play virtual columns. Virtual columns are pretty much free, right? They don't waste a huge amount of space. They could give us a huge amount of information. So here I've added a column to the table. I've called it trunc date. And I've said it's generated always as trunc of date 1000, it's a virtual column. Having added the virtual column, of course, I really have to tell Oracle to collect stats on it. So I've got here gather table stats, method opt, just for column trunc date, size 1, no histogram, don't care about histograms. When I do that and run up my query, which says select where trunc of date 1000 is not equal to that date in 2015, Oracle changes from 50,000 rows, magic 5%, to what is actually basically the right answer, almost all the data. There was one day out of the 1,000 days there where the date was the 1st of December 2015. So nice easy action there. We can spot an opportunity where we can help the optimizer by managing to produce more statistics, more appropriate statistics, without actually adding physical information, a large volume of physical data to the database. That's really rather nice. So there's one sort of approach to dealing with a problem. Dynamic sampling might have helped. Okay, let's go from equality to range-based predicates. Now what I'm going to do here in this slide is do an explain plan and label each statement as I do an explain plan on it, and then I'm just going to pick out the table scan line which will actually appear for each of these and say, well, show me the estimated cardinality for each of these table scans that's going to happen. And my three queries are just slight variations of each other. We've got GTLT greater than, mod 10,000 is greater than, strictly greater than 1200, and mod 10,000 is strictly less than 1800. Then I've got GELT, greater than or equal to, less than, right? Greater than or equal to, strictly less than. And my third one is greater than or equal to and less than or equal to. So easy labels there for my data sets. And having done those three explain plans, I'm just going to call up the statement ID and the cardinality from the plan table, where I've got a table access and the option will be full. So what do we expect to see when we run those queries against the optimizer? If the optimizer does something sensible, what's our sort of intuitive response? Well, we know that we've got a million rows in the table, we know that we've got 10,000 distinct values, we know they're uniformly spread, we would assume therefore that each value would produce about 100 rows. We've got a range there between 1200 and 1800, plus or minus a little rounding at the edges there, that's about 600 values in the range, and we expect the data to be spread evenly through that range. So we hope the optimizer will produce a number which is approximately 60,000 in all three cases, plus or minus a little bit. And fortunately, the optimizer does exactly what we think it probably ought to. Essentially, when it's working out the selectivity here, it says, there's the lowest value in the column, there's the highest value in the column, that's the range you're interested in, your low value to your high value. That distance divided by that distance, broadly speaking, is pretty much the right answer, right? Which is true provided the data is evenly spread throughout the entire range, okay? It's a good approximation. And we look at it, and sure enough, there you go. The answer is about 60,000. Oh, but there's a and six there sitting on the end. We'll call that a rounding error. Add 100, add another 100. Now, where do they come from? Well, basically, it depends whether your ranges are open or closed. Okay, for the, I've just gone completely mad there. For the open range, greater than, less than, Oracle has literally said, do the arithmetic, subtract, that gets your range, subtract high from low, that's the total range, divide. Okay, open values, that's the arithmetic Oracle did. Basically then from that point onwards, there are little variations around the edges, Oracle said if you close the range at all, each equality you throw in there, I'll add 1 over non-distinct. So we add 100 because we've got one equality in our range, we add another 100 because we've got a second equality in our range. That's basically what Oracle's doing. And frankly, you know, when I'm looking at a plan, you know, it's only approximate. I'm quite happy that I got 60,000. That's a good enough approximation. I don't worry too much about exact values until I get onto complicated things like histograms and the effect that histograms actually have on the system. Right. So that's the range-based predicate. Of course, the same sort of thing applies when we don't have a both ends of the range in there. Mod 10,000 is greater than 9,100. Well, Oracle simply says it's the value you want, greater than up to the high value, less than 100, it's the value you want down to the low value. So we get a variation on the formula, but it's the obvious intuitive variation on the formula, right? It's the range you want divided by the total possible range. Of course, things do get a bit funny. We do end up, and this is obviously a simplified variation on it, we do end up with queries which look like this. Select where column is greater than subquery. A subquery guaranteed to return a single value. Right? I have managed to conceal the value 9,100 in a subquery. Mod 10,000 between 9,100 and 9,101, except I've hidden the values. This type of stuff does appear. What does Oracle say? I don't know. Oracle says that. I know what it says, but Oracle says, okay. Oracle says, greater than unknown value? I have to guess. We'll call it 5%. Less than unknown value? I don't know. 5%. Between two unknown values? 0.25%. Right? Mucking about with the equals in this particular case, Oracle says, hey, you know, the equals thing was just a rounding error. Since I've got no idea whatsoever, why do I bother getting it accurately unknown? Right? So it's always just 5%. Oh, except for one thing. When you upgrade to Oracle 12, Oracle gets sneaky. Oracle says, you see that select from dual? It's a constant from dual. I'll just use the constant. when you upgrade queries which do this type of thing in Oracle 12, Oracle says it's not 5% and 0.25% anymore. I know what values you're using. Your execution plans will change. Oh, that particular feature, by the way, has been backported into 11.204. So if any of you are on 11.203, be very careful on the upgrade, because again, you come across this change, execution plans are likely to change. Right. Oh, and this morning I posted just a little blog note which says it's not just select constant from dual, it's select constant where primary key equals constant, a guaranteed one row return. Oracle knows what the constant value is going to be. And perhaps people do actually write code that does that sort of thing, for whatever reason. Okay? And then, when you finally think you've kind of worked out exactly what goes on here with the ranges with unknown values, you discover that Oracle is not consistent. It behaves differently with indexes than it does with tables. So let's take our query here and create an index on that particular column and run exactly these sorts of unknown values queries. So select where mod 10,000 is greater than a hidden 9,100. Right? Again, we'll have to be 11.203 or earlier. What does Oracle say about this? It comes up with different guesses. Right? Single index range scan, single comparison. Oracle says, from the index, I'm going to guess 0.9%. Oh, but when I get to the table, my 9,000 row IDs I picked up in the index are going to pick up 50,000 rows from the table. This is not entirely self-consistent. Similarly, if we have a between range, Oracle says, well, yeah, I'm going to just say 0.45% on my index range scan, right? 4,500 row IDs. And when I get to the table, well, the table, two unknowns, between two unknowns, it's a 0.25%, 2,500 rows. And you get this amazingly stupid feature in your execution plan which says the number of rows I actually visited in the table is not the same as the number of rows I visited at row IDs I picked up from the index. How many of you have seen that? How did Oracle say I've got a million row IDs and then say but I'm only going to pick up 12 rows? And there's no extra predicate when you get to the table. There's no predicate eliminating most of those rows. It's just Oracle saying I used one guess here and another guess there. How are you supposed to figure out what the heck the optimizer's doing? Characters. Characters are greatly entertaining. There's a very important warning about characters here. Alpha 6, you know, nice short character strings here. Alpha 6 is like mm percent. Well, if you look at mm percent, the obvious sort of guess is, yeah, maybe Oracle has something like it's greater than or equal to mm and strictly less than mn, which is, in a sense, the next possible value above the one that you want. Quick check to see if this makes sense with our data set, and yes, conveniently, like something percent, Oracle does indeed do the arithmetic, which is what you might expect. So here we are with our like mm percent, my cardinality shows up at 157. Here's when I put in that greater than or equal to mm, less than the single value which is just higher than the maximum I can expect to see, 157. It's nice, it makes perfect sense, right? It seems to be really quite sensible. Occasionally you see people doing this, you know, someone puts in a value at the front end code, the developer sticks a percent at the front and the back of that, and then says, go and get everything where column is like percent something percent, okay? Or possibly where column is like not like percent something percent. We can just run up the tests. See that 50,000? Which magic number is that? 5%. Interestingly, that is not null, only appeared relatively recently. And of course, that does have an effect on the arithmetic there if we've allowed nulls into the table. But in our case, there's this magic 5%. What about the not like percent mm percent? Well, amazing. This is fantastic. It's the bit which isn't the 5%. It's 95%. Right? Oh, unless you're on 11.1, in which case it's also 5%. And there's another reason why you upgrade and things go crazy. Because when you upgrade, something suddenly says this query is going to return 21 times as much data as it was doing yesterday before the upgrade. No, I don't mean 21, do I? That's left as an exercise. 19. Thanks very much. Okay, so oddities like that come into play. It's interesting what Oracle just simply guesses at. How do you do arithmetic with characters? Actually, if you look at histograms, this gives you a good clue and a very important warning. And I'm going to switch from the 6-character string to the 20-character string to do this. There's a huge number of distinct values in the table here. I'm just going to say let's create a histogram of 10 columns on that particular table. Then I'm going to query the histogram saying take the endpoint values which are stored in the user tab histograms and convert to a hexadecimal number. Right? I'm going to do this because as Tim Hall said in the blog quite recently, I can read hexadecimal and understand ASCII in the raw. Okay? I'm going to convert that into hex. And these are the values you get in this particular data set. Notice, first of all, I've got these very, very large numbers for my endpoint values, but look how many trailing zeros they've got. These numbers have a 15 significant digits to them, right? And a load of trailing zeros. There's some rounding gone into there, or truncating, or whatever. It's 15 significant figures, right? Look at the text, the hex value equivalent. Now, who's really good at this? 61 is lowercase a, 61 is lowercase a, 62 is lowercase b, 73 is lowercase s, right? We can see hex values in here. And when we put them in, a, a, b, s, j, f, and carry on. This thing represents some textual number, a character string, right? If I actually checked carefully what's in the database, the lowest actual stored value is pretty close. It's A, A, B, S, J, F, B, D, and so on. What Oracle has done is take the bytes which have been stored as your string. It's effectively taken the first 15 bytes of that string. If the string's too short, it's padded it either with zero values or hex 20, space in fact, 32s to pad that up to 15 bytes. It's taken that hex number, converted to decimal, chopped off everything and left you with 15 significant figures, converted back to hex and stored it. The upshot of that bit of arithmetic, that bit of manipulation, is that Oracle understands nearly what the first six characters of your string look like. If you're lucky enough to be using a single byte character set. Anyone store URLs? http://, the first seven characters are all the same. You can literally get data sets where Oracle says, I've got 155 million distinct values. The histogram says there's only one value. Oracle has changed that over time, right? If you've got a single character data set, single byte character set. If you've got a 4-byte character set, Oracle might only know about the first 1.5 characters of any string you've got. How is it possibly going to do anything sensible with arithmetic when it's that limited? Fortunately, people don't often say select where this fruit is between apples and bananas. But you know, people do play about with character strings, and actually people play about with character strings having stored numbers or dates as if they were character strings. The optimizer's not going to do the right arithmetic. Get the right data type, help the optimizer do the right thing. Now, I've mentioned nulls, right? Broadly speaking, Oracle just sort of factors out the nulls. I've said we take the density multiplied by the number of rows in the table. Well, actually, of course, Oracle can say take the density, look at the number of rows in the table, minus the number of nulls for that particular column. That's one way of looking at it, or you could say that Oracle says, we'll throw in another factor which says it's rows and tables minus nulls over rows and tables. Whatever, we factor out the fact that there could be some nulls in there. Quick demonstration here, and it's just a very quick approximation. I had this date column with 1,000 dates, select where the date is between, it's the 1st of December 2013 and the 8th of April 2013. Do the arithmetic and Oracle says it's about 91,089 rows. Well, if you check the number of days there are between those two dates, Oracle's got it pretty close. There's always this plus or minus one or two around the edges because of the one over num distinct. This is approximately the right value. I think it's out by my estimate, it's out by two. So there's a little extra fudging going on around the edges, okay? So throw in some nulls. Update the table. I updated 2% of the rows to say nulls. Just every 50th row in the table, I set to null. Okay, what does that do to our cardinality estimate? As you can see here, it's dropped. Well, actually, if you do a little bit of arithmetic, take the original estimate, we've got 98% of the rows are not null. 2% we set to null. Well, it just does happen to pan out quite nicely. Ooh. Can you hear my alarm? Isn't it sweet? That gives me 10 minutes to go. It's working. Brilliant. Okay. So we get some ideas there of dealing with nulls. I'm not going to go into greater detail. But then we get into things, again, terribly important here, going out of range, right? Let's have something which is the order date on a table. And we've got an index on the order date because we love to say, tell me about the orders that have been placed in the last 2 hours, right? What's the problem with the statistics on the order date, especially and particularly if it's a time, date and time? You collect stats and the very next order that goes into the system has a date which is higher than the highest value in the stats. You're straight out of range. Right? That's a killer. I got paid £3,500 for telling someone that once. I was happy. Thank you. I like it when the audience laughs. Right, so I've got a couple of examples here. I'm going to take the mod 200 column. Mod 200 equals 100 to show you what we should get when we're in range with equality. Let's go a bit out of range, 250. We go further out of range, 350. And let's do a greater than 350, greater than a value which is outside the range. Well, here we go. With our column equals 200, we've got 200 equals 100. We've got 200 distinct values. We're going to get 5,000 rows, million divided by 200. So that's our basic column equals constant if we pick a value which is in the range. Okay? Fine. Quite what we expect. What if mod 200 equals 250? We know that that is not possible. What's Oracle got? 3,719. Okay? It's dropped off from 5,000. Let's go further outside the range. 1,206. It's dropped off even further. Basically, Oracle is saying, the further out you are, the less optimistic I am. Right? It's a linear decay type of effect. And then we do this, right? Mod 200 is greater than or equal to 350, range-based predicate. So the stuff which equals 350 gets us 1,206 rows. The stuff which equals 250 and all the rest which is even greater than 350 still gets us 1,206 rows. Imagine what you could do if you said, show me the stuff where it's equal to 350, 450, and 550. Right? There's more of that stuff than there is of the stuff which is everything which is greater than 350. It's not consistent. We have a consistency problem. Greater than, out of range. Right. What's Oracle playing at, basically? I tend to draw this graph as the indicator. We've got uniform data. We've got values spread between 0 and 199. If we graph the frequency, the number of rows for each distinct value, we get a flat line there at 5,000. Okay? So Oracle says for handling out of range, I will take this, 0 to 199, I will extend it to the left, I will extend it to the right. Same distance outwards, I'll do a straight line graph which brings me from 5,000 down to 0. Okay? This is what I mean by the linear decay. And now I can either do this by arithmetic, of course, which is what the optimizer does, or by drawing pictures. 250, it's about there, so I go up to the graph, read across. That's 3,119. 350, I think, is about there. Missed. Okay, up, read across, it's 1,206. That's what Oracle is doing with equality. It's linear decay. And then if you go greater than, Oracle says, well, forget the greater bit, it's just the same as equality. Why is this such a disaster? Why did someone pay me a small fortune? Like nearly my airfare to America business class. Why did they pay me that much to tell them something like this? Because they had an order date, and they had queries which said, show me the orders placed in the last 15 minutes. Right? And 15 minutes and 1 second after they had collected stats, Oracle was saying, the number of orders placed in the last 15 minutes is, well, let's see how many orders you place in any unit of time. They had a timestamp, they were placing 5 orders per second. So when the stats were correct, Oracle was saying, well, yeah, we've got about 3,500 orders here. And as that 15 minutes ticked away, that 3,500 dropped and dropped and dropped. And if someone happened to start that query 15 minutes after the stats had been collected, Oracle said, you've got 5 orders, not 3,500 orders. Right? So provided someone ran the query soon enough after stats have been collected, they got a good execution plan. If the first time that query was run was more than 15 minutes after the stats have been collected, they got disastrous execution plans. A solution to that problem, by the way, set column stats, dbmsstats.setcolumnstats. Anytime you change the stats on this table, the very next thing you do is run a piece of code which says, don't believe the stats, overwrite them, make the high value on this column 24 hours from now. Right? Change the high values to something which is sufficiently far away that it's truthful until the stats get collected again. And then you keep changing the high values ahead of the time that is actually strictly true, but it's actually what you want the optimizer to believe. Set index stats, set column stats, sorry, you've got all these set options which are available to you in order to manipulate the stats. And it's legal. There's even a MOS node which shows an example of it, but my blog is also a good source of information. Now, I've got 5 minutes left, which means I'm going to accelerate slightly. Okay, multiple predicates, select where? Mod 200 equals and RAND 300 equals. We can do some arithmetic. We know we've got 5,000 rows for this one. We've got 3,333 rows for this one. Oracle's prediction is 17 rows. How did it get to there? Because basically Oracle says, well, of your one row in 300 for this, one in 200 will look like that. Or vice versa, of the one in 200 for this predicate, one in 300 will look like that. So it's selectivity. Oracle simply says, work out the separate values, multiply together. And we get 1 in 200, 1 in 300, gives us 1 in 60,000. There's our combined selectivity, multiplied by a million rows. So anding together predicates gives us simply multiply the predicate selectivities together. Or there's 5,000 which are mod 200 equals 100. There's 3,333 there. We want both sets of data. Add those two numbers, you get 8,333, but the optimizer predicts slightly less. Why? Because if you just add these two numbers, you've counted some of them twice. You've counted the ones which are both 200s and 300s, sorry, the mod 200 is 100, mod 300 is 150 twice. So you have to subtract those off. So this is your formula. Or you add together the two selectivities and subtract the combined selectivity. In other words, you subtract that multiplicand. Okay, that's how Oracle handles ORs. And of course, basically what Oracle is doing is saying all your column predicates are independent. And of course, that's going to give you the wrong answers at some stage. Right? There are bound to be situations. The example I've come up here is, what if you run a delivery service, you pick up parcels and you deliver them somewhere else. And then you run up a query which says, tell me about things which I picked up in the last 24 hours which I have not yet delivered. Well, the things you haven't delivered are almost always going to be the things you've only just picked up, and vice versa. You're almost putting in the same predicate twice. There's a huge overlap between the two predicates. But Oracle says, 1 in 1,000 picked up in the last 24 hours, 1 in 1,000 not yet delivered. You're fantastic. You've only missed out on 1 in 1,000,000 in the last 24 hours. Right? And so you get the wrong plan. So the sort of working out that you have to deal with this one is column stats. Well, two strategies. You could do dynamic sampling at level 4, so that Oracle says, I will look at the data and I will discover that actually the basic arithmetic is wrong. Or you could create column stats. We have this predicate, which is a combined set of stats. Oracle's done its arithmetic for this, 1 in 200 and all the rest of it, comes up with an extremely wrong answer. So what we can do is simply say, let us gather table stats. And notice here I've said method opt. I'm collecting for a column. Here's its definition, no histogram. You can actually do a create extended stats call to define something which looks like this, but actually you can just gather stats on something like that expression. Column stats, multiple column stats, okay? Gather those table stats. Suddenly, when you run your query, Oracle says, this is an equality expression that looks like that. I've got the stats, I know what it should look like. It is very good, but it is very limited, right? It only works for equalities. If you don't have very many combinations, and in Oracle 12, you can go up to 2,000. If you don't have many combinations, you can get a frequency histogram of combinations, and that can be very, very helpful. Can't work with range-based predicates, right? If you put in a query which goes out of range, Oracle says, forget this, can't use this. Bit sad that I feel it really ought to, but it doesn't. Plus, you've added a virtual column, yet another version of a virtual column to the table, and for these things called extended stats, you're only allowed 20 of those before you hit the limit, a hard limit that Oracle has imposed. And that is my phone telling me it's time to stop. 20 sets of extended stats. But it could be extremely useful. One of the very sad things, of course, about things like virtual columns and extended stats, and even to some extent function-based indexes, is that there are limitations on when Oracle can use them and side effects as to what happens. You end up with things like, if you're running a standby database, a table which has got, I think, still extended stats on the table can't actually get across to the standby database because something breaks. You get odd little glitches like this. Check very, very carefully before you say, hey, I've got this great solution, yeah? Everything else is broken, but my query now runs fast. Okay, so be careful. There are limitations and there are little problems. And at that point, how about that? Time's up. Thanks very much.